the cross, and the lynching tree. It doesn't get any more provocative than that. But nevertheless, it is this provocation that sits at the heart of what biblical spirituality means for Dr. James Cone. The mystery, the absurdity of the cross, understood from the vantage point of the lynching tree, seen in black experience in America, is a compelling locus which informs his theological vocation. Cicero said, "Let not the word cross be in your ears, your eyes, or your thoughts." But in Cone's theology, the cross from the vantage point of the lynching tree becomes the framework by which Cone understands God in the midst of a crucified people. The cross of Christ then becomes the mystery that illuminates the enigma of life. It points to something unreal in our so-called reality, something unreal in our notion of humanity, observed in our crucifixions, our conquests, and our violences. So Cone muses, what blocks the American imagination from seeing the connection between the cross and the lynching tree? What does this type of theology say to America and to American exceptionalism, to triumphalism? What does our history of domestic terrorism, seen from the vantage point of the lynching tree, say about the so-called terrorists abroad? Perhaps more importantly for this audience, what does it say to American theology? Not just in terms of Jesus the crucified, but in terms of crucified peoples. Or as his friend, the historian of religion, Charles Long says, what does it mean to do theology when you take into consideration the land and the exchanges which take place within it? Is theology even possible? But Cone presumes that it is. And he responds with the cross and the lynching tree. And for us to respond in silence to such questions born out of our history is to have what Jürgen Habermas calls a false response. He says that the person or nation who is addressed and remains silent clothes himself or herself or itself in an aura of indeterminate significance and imposes silence. So silence, he says, is imposed. That means that silence takes on an authoritative character. So Habermas says Sartre has rightly called silence reactionary. What will our response be? In fact, until we're ready to hear this theology of James Cone, we have to raise the question of whether we're doing theology or ideology. And the cross then becomes a quintessential symbol that exposes the ideological nature of our theology and how it often functions in a deleterious way, revealing our brokenness, the contradictions, and the absurdity. And yet Cone, he doesn't rest just in the tragic, but he reveals in hope expressed in the tragic beauty of the blues, individual expression, creativity, that teaches us that resistance isn't limited to organized political struggle. In fact, as black people would say, God helps us to make a way out of no way. As many of you know, Dr. Cone's witness has to be understood within what Hans-Georg Gadamer would call the effective historical consciousness of a people. Black people and their relationship to American history. And in this line and direction, we with Cone, we become part of a river. These waters that caught in the current, in these waters that are a type of tidal surge in some way that emerges from black experience, and he beckons us to wade in these waters with him. In fact, for Dr. Cone, this work is not an end. It is a beginning. Last night he called it a prolegomena. Not a final word, but the beginning of a conversation, he says. So we're here today, and we're honored to have Dr. James Cone as a part of our panel. In fact, no one is more gracious to their interlocutors, but no one is more challenging or passionate, especially when it comes to this subject. So we want to offer our thanks to Dr. Cone for being here, and then we also want to thank Dr. Otto Maduro and Robert Puckett for making this panel possible. First, we will hear from our brother Dwight Hopkins, who is no stranger to Chicago, and because in many ways this is his house. I mean, we're visiting, he works here. He's a constructed theologian working in the areas of contemporary models of theology. In fact, when we look at his work, he's speaking in many ways a public theology. In fact, for a long time, he's been talking about trying to find the right shoes to fit our feet. And so we're grateful to have him. Also, we're going to have the distinguished professor from Messiah College, Dr. Richard Hughes, sitting to my left. And Hughes will come second after Hopkins. And I know Dr. Hughes quite well. He was both my teacher and my friend. And he follows in many ways the line and tradition of the significant religious historian Sidney Mead and others. But in his more recent work, he's become even more grounded in a kind of socio-political critique and books such as The Myths America Lives By. After Richard, our third panelist, womanist theologian, Dr. Angela Sims of St. Paul University, who's done a very important work which includes preserving Black lynching stories as accounts of faith. A remarkable type of public theology, kind of theological autobiography. And after her, we have my good friend, James Noel from San Francisco Theological Seminary, who in many ways is, I call him a Renaissance man, bringing an aesthetic sensibility, following the line and direction of Charles Long. And so I'm looking forward to this panel and hearing what they have to say. But we're going to begin because Dr. James Cone is a man of the church. We're going to begin with a song that conjures up the same kind of ideas that his book conjures up. And that song is going to be sung by my lovely wife, Dr. Joy Carr. Please come on up.
Good evening. Good evening. Soon I will be done with the troubles of the world, troubles of the world, troubles of the world. Oh, soon I will be done with the troubles of the world. I'm going home to live with God. No more weeping and wailing. No more.
Good evening, good afternoon. It's a privilege to have been invited to participate with these esteemed colleagues here and to say a few brief words about James Hal Cone's latest text. James H. Cone is the Charles A. Briggs Distinguished Professor of Systematic Theology at Union Theological Seminary in New York. He has penned another theological pioneering text. In this instance, his is the first sustained juxtaposition of the Christian cross with the lynching tree of Black Americans as a theological problematic. What is at stake in his close contrast and comparison of Jesus' crucifixion and Black people's lynching is the very authenticity of the Christian gospel and the hope of healing racial violence, continually sowing seeds of church and societal divisions. Moreover, Cone compellingly argues and prophetically warns that there cannot be an understanding of Christian identity in the United States of America with its complicity in the brutal legacy of slavery and what he calls, quote, white supremacy. Indeed, Cone's latest publication continues and deepens the foundational theological challenge explored in all of his 13 groundbreaking books. That is, how does a systematic theologian and Christian minister reconcile Jesus' gospel message of liberation with the reality of Black oppression? In a sense, this text is a culmination of Cone's theological journey of making sense out of the theodicy of Black American people's suffering and the paradox of hope proposed by a crucified Christ. Since his first 1969 text, Black Theology and Black Power, until the current, The Cross and the Lynching Tree, this plumb line research question has acted as a spiritual wrestling with Cone's head and heart. Methodologically, chapter one unfolds his continual research question and fundamental argument. Cone begins by presenting a carefully nuanced and subtly textured account of the origin and history of white Christian explicit rationalization for the lynching of Black bodies in the United States. Such Christian ritual practices are described as the lynching era from 1880 to 1940. Yet Black communities did not succumb totally to a, quote, white Christian terrorism of lynching. Individuals and families survived by appropriating and syncretizing their own African-American resources. Specifically, Blacks created and deployed the blues music genre as affirmation of their humanity, and they forged a poetics and practice of a Black Christianity pregnant with common sense hermeneutics. Black religion gave hope. It interpreted Jesus' lynching on a cross as a signal of evil not having the final word on human life. Chapter two poses the logical next question in the flow of Cone's argument. If Jesus' murder on the cross and Black people's murder on a tree have so much obvious resonances, if not exact parallels, why have the majority of white USA theologians and religious leaders not seen the apparent interconnection? Cone digs deeply into the theological and ethical writings of Reinhold Niebuhr to find an answer. And even Niebuhr, a white scholar, seemingly sympathetic to the plight of blacks relative to Christian white supremacy, failed to draw the obvious conclusion of theological ties between the cross and lynching. Niebuhr declares the cross as truth, for its location is the site of God's revelation. But Cohn critiques Niebuhr for not advancing to the similar revelatory status of black lynched victims. Cohn castigates Niebuhr for having eyes to see black suffering, but lacking a heart to feel this suffering as his own. Chapter 3 provides the black religious tradition's ability to do what Niebuhr and other white religious scholars fail to resolve. And here, Cohn introduces Martin Luther King Jr.'s theological yoking of the lynching tree with the cross. King understood the cross as God's highest love for human life, and the lynching tree as a symbolic essence of hate in America. Chapter 4 weaves a theological thread of investigation throughout fascinating and disparate forms of the black aesthetic. And in this creative process, Cohn discovers how many black artists utilize the realm of the poetic to tie the religious significance of Jesus' death on a wooden cross with blacks' death on a wooden tree. Cohn suggests that perhaps unencumbered by theological doctrine and ecclesiological strictures, the African-American literary imagination remains the most potent space for foregrounding the cross brutality and hope with the lynching's insanity perpetrated by Christian white supremacy. And with chapter 5, Cohn examines the vibrant role of women in the debate. He reminds us that black women were also lynched, and they likewise undertook nationwide leadership in the anti-lynching campaigns. Black women's sociological, historical, and religious practices in the campaigns then enable Cohn to engage the strictly theological contentions of womanist critiques and affirmations about the redemptive nature of the suffering cross. Womanist theological and ethical argumentations have surfaced a trend painting all vicarious suffering, especially that of Jesus' cross, as wrong. Rather, the cross demarcates, quote, man's evil against man, close quote. Cohn, however, sides with those womanists whose old rugged cross has sustained them in good and bad times. Cohn's conclusion section offers profound healing and hope out of the twisted wooden cross and the twisted lynched black bodies. For him, Christ's death denotes salvation and healing for blacks and whites and America, because God was revealed in Jesus on the cross. The cross and the lynching tree complement each other, reminding us of human terror and heavenly power on earth. James H. Cohn continues to be one of the best writers because he is one of the clearest thinkers. The clarity of thought similarly allows him to complicate what might seem non-complex theological matters. Furthermore, Cohn reminds the world constantly that writing is fighting. Most avoid and deny the controversial. Cohn relishes it in the absolute eradication of white supremacist structures. Indeed, one could argue that this book points to the spirit of his family's ancestors and the God of his faith. Both have anointed his life to deconstruct and make sense out of a peculiar American phenomenon, the contradiction between Christian white supremacy and Christianity's goal of justice. In addition, the cross and the lynching tree exhibits a certain historical symmetry. This text and Cone's first book, Black Theology and Black Power, published in March of 1969, both these texts grapple with the theological themes of white Christian racism, Jesus Christ, and liberation. And one could possibly conclude that his many publications and his lectures over the decades are anchored in at least these three themes. This is his passion, this is his calling, this is his identity. A return to history and a hope for new life. Let me just end by asking two questions and making one statement. For Professor Cone, how would you compare and contrast this latest book with your first published work, Black Theology and Black Power of 1969? And secondly, what does the cross and the lynching tree tell us about how to do theology in the 21st century? That is, what does this book tell us about the discipline of theology? And just a brief statement. I think that it's important to be clear that Black Theology of Liberation looks at Black people's positive relationship to God. And in this process, it runs against negative structures and strictures, which, being a theology that is prophetic, has to say a word, has to speak truth to power. And I once asked Professor Cone how he was able to develop a discipline that is not only an indigenous American discipline, but has global implications. He said to me at that time that he attempted to do, and I would say successfully do, because he would never say he successfully did it, but I will say he successfully did it, three ways. One, he said that, one, it's important to publish books. That is, if we're going to have a conversation in the area of discipline of theology, then we must have something to say in a compelling way. And I think those of us who have learned from him and been students of his and continue to learn from him can say, yes, he did. In addition to publishing books, he said, second, it is important to train doctoral students so that a development of a theology is not simply a flash in the pan. It is something that has weight. It is something that matters. It is something that's worth training generations to take up and broaden. And third, he said it was important to globalize Black theology. And I think we would all have to say that he too successfully did this. Obviously, we are aware of the work that he has done in the Ecumenical Association of Third World Theologians, but we can also say he has impacted thinkers and theological discourse from England to Germany. So in a sense, Black Theology Liberation is an attempt to bring accountability to Black religion and Black thought in the context of the larger American narrative, because Black theology is concerned that indeed another world is possible. Thank you.
I want to say as I began to Raymond Carr that I am honored beyond anything I could have ever expected or hoped for, Raymond, that you asked me to be part of this panel. Thank you, sir. Because James Cone's book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree, elicited from me such a deep emotional response, there is no way I can reflect on this book in any kind of a detached academic way. All I can do is share the story of my own theological and ethical journey in the light of the cross on the one hand and the lynching tree on the other, and then offer some brief reflections on what I think my journey with respect to race and indeed the journey of many other white American Christians, might finally mean. From the outset, I need to be clear that my story is not my story alone. For at the very least, my story sheds light on the Southern Christian tradition in which I was raised, the Church of Christ, and the way that church related or failed to relate to the cross and the lynching tree. Beyond that, I suspect that my story also sheds light on the role of the cross and the lynching tree in the larger world of white Christianity in the United States. When I read Cone's words that, and I'm quoting now, nothing, absolutely nothing, was uglier than lynching in all of its many forms, hanging, burning, beating, dragging, and shooting, as well as torture, mutilation, and especially castration. And yet so many were blind, deaf, and dumb. When I read those words, I could only reflect on the extent to which I, too, have been blind and deaf and dumb, and to some degree still am. And when I read that Reinhold Niebuhr could write and preach about the cross with, and this is a quote again, with profound theological imagination, and say nothing of how the violence of white supremacy invalidated the faith of white churches, and then heard Cone say, quote, "It takes a lot of theological blindness to do that," I knew that theological blindness had clouded my vision too for a very long time, and to some extent still does. And when I read that during his childhood, Cone, quoting again, heard a lot about the cross at the Macedonia AME Church in Bearden, Arkansas, and when I read that, quote, "black ministers preached about Jesus' death more than any other theme because they saw in Jesus' suffering and persecution a parallel to their own encounter with slavery and segregation and the lynching tree," when I read those words, I had to confess that as a kid growing up, I never heard much about the cross at all. I never heard much about the cross for several reasons. In the first place, in our tradition, we chiefly sought to conform our churches to what we took as the biblical model for the primitive church, not so much to conform our lives to the model of the cross of Christ. And second, we never talked much about the cross because we seldom talked about grace. Instead, we talked about right behavior and right belief and correctly implementing the biblical model of the church. Until the 1960s, when Churches of Christ finally discovered grace, ours was pretty much a theology of works. But Cone has helped me see another reason for our failure to preach the message of the cross of Christ. And that reason, quite simply, is our failure to discern the horrors of the lynching tree. In the privileged world in which I grew up, we fully subscribed to the Horatio Alger myth that anyone in America who's willing to work can succeed. And because we read the Bible through the lens of white privilege, we essentially ignored the cross and imagined instead that hard work could bring salvation in this very same way hard work could bring success. Our theological world stood therefore in stark and tragic relief against the world of those black Christians who, as Cone reminds us, preached about Jesus' death more than any other theme because they saw in Jesus' suffering and persecution a parallel to their own encounter with slavery, segregation, and the lynching tree. But there's more, so much more. For as a kid growing up, I not only failed to discern the lynching tree, I failed to discern much of anything about the lives of black people. Even though I grew up in Texas, where blacks lived in every hamlet, every town, and every city. In Dallas, where I spent my childhood from age 6 to 10, I would see them from time to time, especially the women, standing on street corners, dressed in their freshly pressed gray or white dresses. I realize now that those women were waiting for buses to take them to the homes of white people where they served as nannies or cleaning women. But to my white 8-year-old eyes, those black women all looked alike, and I often wondered how anyone could tell them apart. I realize now they all looked alike only because I always saw them from a considerable distance, from the windows of our family car, which sometimes passed through their neighborhoods but never stopped. And as a result, I never got close enough, even to discern their features, much less to hear their stories or even to know their names. That failure to see would define my relation to African American people for years to come. And I therefore saw myself very clearly, as a matter of fact, in a statement Cone made about Reinhold Niebuhr. Niebuhr, Cone wrote, quote, did not realize the depth of black despair because he did not listen to Malcolm X and other black nationalists who were speaking at Temple Number 7 and in the streets of Harlem, just a few blocks away from his office at Union Seminary. Had he turned on the radio or television, Cone continued, he could have heard the eloquent and powerful voice of Malcolm talking about the limits of the bourgeois civil rights movement and its leaders. Likewise, I attended college in Arkansas, Cone's home state, from 1961 to 1965, just a few hundred miles from many of the greatest struggles of the civil rights movement. The Children's March in Birmingham in 1963, for example, or the Selma March in 1964. And I sailed through life blissfully unaware of the great moral struggles that played out in front of my very eyes. And today, we'll have to confess to you, I have no firsthand memory of any of those events at all. Malcolm X was murdered on my birthday, February the 21st, during my senior year in college, 1965. I'm not sure I even knew who Malcolm was. When I was in college, I majored in Bible, but I cannot recall that a single Bible professor told the students to pay attention to the freedom movement, or better still, to get involved. Like so many other religion professors at so many other schools throughout the country, including Union Seminary, apparently, my professors never connected the freedom movement to the power of the cross. But I must finally blame myself, not my professors, for my failure to notice the great black struggle for equal rights. For I had been deaf and dumb and blind long before I entered college. While I did interact with a handful of black students in my high school in San Angelo, Texas, I have no firsthand memory of the freedom movement between 1955, the year Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, E.D. Nixon, and others led the Montgomery bus boycott and thereby launched the movement, and 1961, the year I graduated from high school, even though some of the most decisive struggles occurred during those years. It really shakes me to my toes to admit before you that none of those events played a sufficiently significant role in my life to cause me to remember them as a meaningful part of my own personal journey. And so today, I wonder, how could I have been so blind? In one of the most powerful statements in his book, Professor Cone writes that between 1880 and 1940, white Christians lynched nearly 5,000 black men and women in a manner with obvious echoes of the Roman crucifixion of Jesus. And yet those Christians did not see the irony or contradiction in their actions. And the question that cries from the blood-soaked ground for some sort of answer is once again that question, why? Why could they, why could we not discern the massive contradiction that stood at the heart of their actions? And a more basic question is this: what allowed so many white Christians, people just like me, to have eyes that did not see and ears that did not hear, and who therefore ignored black suffering altogether? The answer to those questions emerges in the judgment of so many blacks over so many years of American history, the judgment they have made regarding what is typically passed for the Christian religion in white America. And their unanimous verdict has been this, unanimous verdict, that the religion that has dominated this country has never been the Christian faith at all. In 1829, David Walker asked, have not the Americans the Bible in their hands? Do they believe it? And his answer was clear. Walker said, surely they do not. 16 years later, in 1845, Frederick Douglass lamented that, quote, between the Christianity of this land and the Christianity of Christ, I recognize the widest possible difference, so wide that to receive the one as good, pure, and holy is of necessity, to reject the other as bad and corrupt and wicked. Indeed, he said, I can see no reason but the most deceitful one for calling the religion of this land Christianity at all. In the early 20th century, W.E.B. Du Bois flatly pronounced, quote, white Christianity a miserable failure. In 1963, Martin Luther King wrote of the churches in the American South that on sweltering summer days and crisp autumn mornings, I have looked at her beautiful churches with their spires pointing heavenward, and over again I have found myself asking, what kind of people worship here? Who is their God? And now in our time, James Cone, reflecting on the cross and the lynching tree, perceptibly writes that, quote, white conservative Christianity's blatant endorsement of lynching as a part of its religion and white liberal Christians' silence about lynching placed both of them outside of Christian identity. But this cataclysmic failure in Christian ethics is inevitably rooted in a cataclysmic failure of Christian theology. And those two failures undermine from a very early date the integrity of the Christian faith in much of white America. Throughout his book, Professor Cone reflects on the biblical meaning of the cross. The cross, he writes, speaks to oppressed people in ways that Jesus' life, teachings, and even his resurrection do not. The cross places God in the midst of crucified people, in the midst of people who were hung and shot and burned and tortured. But many white Christians in the United States have routinely connected the power of the cross chiefly to the world to come and have seldom seen its implications for human suffering in the here and now. Ida B. Wells got this. She understood and wrote, as quoted by Cone, that our American Christians are too busy saving the souls of white Christians from burning in hellfire to save the lives of black ones from present burning in fires kindled by those white Christians. Martin Luther King spoke of that same theological failure in slightly different terms. In the midst of a mighty struggle to rid our nation of racial and economic injustice, he wrote, I have heard so many ministers say, those are social issues with which the gospel has no real concern. And I have watched as so many churches commit themselves to a completely otherworldly religion which made a strange distinction between body and soul, sacred and secular. The second theological failure of white American Christians, especially evangelicals, is the way they so often turn the Christian faith into a strictly private affair. And as Cone said of Niebuhr, it takes a lot of theological blindness to do that. Blindness indeed. From start to finish, the Christian gospel is the story of God's compassion for the poor, for the hungry, and for marginalized people who bear the yoke of oppression. Then many white American Christians typically understand the gospel only in terms of Jesus and me. And that is why, as a kid growing up in Texas, I learned right away that the great moral issues were drinking and smoking and dancing and heavy petting. Questions of systematic social justice like segregation or racial oppression never registered on our radar screens as issues that should even compel our attention. Now finally, in light of the near unanimous verdict of countless black Christians that the dominant religion of whites in the United States has not been the Christian faith, but something else, I want to ask, what is that something else? Put another way, if for many whites the Christian religion pertains chiefly to the sweet by and by, what religion connects those people to the real world in the here and now, the world in which all of us must live? I have long believed that the religion of many white American Christians has little to do with biblical faith and little to do with the cross of Christ. and even less to do with the lynching tree, but everything to do with what I like to call the great American myths. It seems to me there are five of those myths. The myth of the chosen nation selected by God for a special mission in the world. The myth of nature's nation living out those self-evident truths that reflect God's own design. The myth of the millennial nation ushering in the golden age for all humankind. The myth of the innocent nation that fights the powers of evil but never gets blood on its hands. And finally, the myth of the Christian nation, the very claim that so many blacks have rejected. Like many other white school children in this country, I grew up believing those myths. And more than anything else, those are the myths that rendered me deaf and dumb and blind on the question of race. Some years ago, I wrote a book about those myths. I called it Myths America Lives By. Throughout that book, I lifted up the voices of prophetic black leaders to critique those myths, since many blacks have viewed those myths as ideological tools of oppression. But for many white Christians in the United States, those myths point to the virtue, the piety, and the innocence of the American nation. Now, at this point, I want to be crystal clear. There are blacks in this country who buy into those myths, and there are whites who reject them. But by and large, whites, not blacks, have perpetuated that mythology. If those who believe that those myths are right, that we live in a nation in sync with God's will for all humankind, a nation that God has called to redeem the world, a nation that battles evil but always preserves its own innocence, if those who believe those myths are right, there is really no need for the cross in this present life, or even in the life to come, for the nation has become our Savior. And in such a nation, the cross, and the lynching tree can only be illusions.
Sister Joy, thank you for ushering us into that place where we remember that simultaneously we stand in places that are both sites of horror, and yet they are also places that we are called to remember as sacred and hallowed ground. James H. Cone's The Cross and the Lynching Tree, informed by a socio-historical analysis, demonstrates the extent to which these two potent symbols inhibit some Christians' ability to live a more faithful witness. This book, interweaving personal recollections of lynching culture, challenges readers to think deeply about a living history that is fraught with tension, ambiguity, and hypocrisy. Cone's theologically informed memoir highlights an often unspoken truth. For many persons born between 1895 and 1938, to be black in the United States of America necessitated an ability to absorb pervasive, life-negating cultural practices. To come of age in varied shades of blackness in the late 19th and early 20th centuries symbolized to many African Americans who remember lynching that courage or civility in any era must always be informed by an analysis of the United States' complicated and tortured fascination with terror. Yet lynching is frequently associated with notions of culpability, self-reproach, remorsefulness, and humiliating disgrace that contribute to the continued silence of one too many African Americans whose lived experiences can function as points of inquiry to broaden an understanding of and construct alternative meanings of truth and justice as a response to domestic terror. Given its lingering, though often unacknowledged residual effects, The Cross and the Lynching Tree is a timely reminder and a call to action to acknowledge that lynching memories, like slave narratives, offer a different lens through which to evaluate personal and communal values. We need only recount the plethora of nooses in public spaces during the 2008 and the empty chair lynchings during this year's presidential campaign to grasp the import of Cone's recollection that personal life-defining moments often invite us to consider how a collective memory of African Americans' lynching narratives can influence what is often accepted in one too many churches as theological truth claims that are an anathema to both our historical and contemporary reality. With compelling evidence, Cone supports his theological claim that a spiritualized cross and a lynching tree shrouded in silence distort our ability to acknowledge our own complicity in the advancement of a revisionist history that is tantamount to a cheapened form of salvation. After all, life in the shadow of the noose is fraught with ambiguous tension, complicated by traditions and compounded by a desire on the one hand to give voice to practices that reflect the worst of human nature, and on the other hand, to honor that which contributes to the well-being of all God's creation, to participate in an always unfolding eschaton. Readers familiar with lynching and a culture of lynching in the United States will applaud Cone's ability to provide a succinct synopsis of the societal attraction to terror that was, as noted by several scholars across disciplines, not a Southern phenomenon, but America's sin. Drawn on a plethora of interdisciplinary resources, Cone describes an existential reality that required Blacks to exercise creative strategies to combat an evil that was etched into this nation's cultural DNA. With theological acumen, Cone illustrates the power of the blues and African American poetry and prose, as well as the hermeneutical aptitude of Black preachers to imagine a God who sojourned with them during an era when death at the hands of persons known and unknown was a constant possibility. Cone's analysis is most brilliant when he interrogates the ability of white American Christians to fail to draw the obvious correlations between the crucifixion and lynching, while at the same time emphasizing Black American artistic expressions that gave voice to this reality. Cone's comparative analysis of two of this country's most respected theologians and public scholars, Reinhold Niebuhr and Martin Luther King Jr., is a poignant reminder that contextual particularities do inform individual and communal responses to sin. For Cone, this acknowledgement should compel readers to open themselves to the possibilities of what he describes as a hope beyond tragedy. But herein lies his challenge. Cone asks us to subject previously accepted practices and unquestioned truths that eclipse the power of the cross and the lynching tree to a deeper interrogation from which emerges, and I quote, the imagination to relate the message of the cross to one's own social reality, end quote. But unlike the Jewish Holocaust that has international recognition, lynching continues to be associated with shame and denial. Shame embodied by one too many who lived under this regime of terror, and denial by one too many who refute evidence preserved on postcards and other visual depictions. Because of its lingering, though often unacknowledged, residual effects, dialogues on and about lynching cannot and should not be ignored. Conversations with African Americans who remember lynching can add depth to existing theological contributions on this difficult topic. Of note is that retired educators, clergy, scientists, veterans, entrepreneurs, lawyers, and laborers, whom I interviewed during 2009 and 2010, discuss lynching because for them, historical remembrance is a theological ethical mandate. Whether they acquired the equivalent of a first grade education or achieved the highest degree in their respective field, their lynching narratives, when viewed as oral epistles, challenge us to reassess notions of courageous truth-telling. From their recollections of aborted lynchings and strategies of survival, African Americans who remember lynching illustrate how stories shaped and still unfolded in the shadow of lynching trees influence conceptions of righteousness. Thus, to accept Dr. Cone's work, The Cross and the Lynching Tree, as a theological mandate is also to acknowledge that African-American lynching narratives are not ex nihilo accounts. Rather, these memories are intricately woven aspects of individuals' lives which offer us a glimpse into cultural, social, religious, political dimensions of America's national narratives. Viewed as such, lynching narratives are both personal and collective. Framed as they are by a historical reality that is neither acontextual nor episodic anomalies. At some level, however, lynching narratives signify that the proverbial maxim, treat others as you wish to be treated, continues ultimately to shift responsibility for life-affirming human interaction to persons who are often targeted for systematic deconstruction or systematic destruction. This stance can and perhaps should raise questions about behavioral patterns that are so intricately woven into the fiber of America's sense of entitlement that it allows one too many citizens to become anesthetized to practices such as waterboarding that, if observed in other contexts, would be characterized as barbaric. To some extent, then, we could make a claim that to assess techniques employed by diasporic persons of African descent who live in the United States is to engage in a process by which we glean insight into ways in which a particular generation navigated mob rule and Southern, albeit national horrors that may challenge assumptions about what it means to self-identify as Christian in occupied territory that continues to market itself as the land of the free and the home of the brave. In spite of national xenophobic sentiments, my research with African American elders who remember lynching suggests that their faith in God enabled them to arrive at a point where they refused to allow lynching culture to dictate their own sense of beingness. For instance, at 91 years old, retired educator Mrs. Catherine Clark Fletcher in Omaha, Nebraska, recalled, and I quote, "A heavy burden had been lifted, and she had let the hate go," end quote, when she decided not to allow someone else's hatred to determine her worldview. Through a variety of means, to confront, to refute, and to divest ourselves of white supremacy's imposed unquestioned power can be compared to a process of rebirth. Particularly, this imagery of rebirth is an invitation to examine previously unquestioned doctrinal statements and theological truth claims often masked in ambiguous universal Christian terminology. To come of age in a culture of terror and yet to arrive at a point where self-abnegation is transformed to love of self, such that it becomes a catalyst to call into account misrepresentations of justice and righteousness, is in some regards an embodied expression of atonement. This act of reinterpretation conveys the power of resurrection that emerges from and is informed not by a death penalty enactment, but whether by the potency of words attributed to Jesus, "It is finished," even as Jesus hung on the cross. On this side of Calvary, an important thing to note about this proclamation from one acknowledged by many to be the way, the truth, and the life, is the manner in which veracity, when perceived as a real or imagined threat, can evoke a violent response. This declaration also signals that we do our work, as Dr. Cone so aptly demonstrates in his service to the academy, to the church, and to society. We do our work, ever mindful of extreme measures that may be employed to reinforce meanings embedded in social symbols when prophetic utterances name unambiguously structures that undergird assumed imposed privilege. While a majority of the persons who shared their memories of lynching and a culture of lynching with me view Jesus' crucifixion as essential to their understanding of salvation, the potency of the words uttered on the cross posits that it is possible without bloodletting, whether a form of sanction or extra-legal capital punishment, that rebirth can usher forth from an awareness that actions which contribute to the common good of the least of these contain the power to transform us and the world in which we live. It is this sense of connectedness that can diffuse that which seeks to kill, to steal, and to destroy in a manner that neither ignores culturally embedded hatred nor romanticizes our existential reality. Rather, to engage in a critical, constructive, contextual analysis is contingent on our ability to cultivate behaviors that enable us to devise and implement techniques with which to navigate systems, confident that God will meet us in the very particularity of our situation. Individually and collectively, African American lynching narratives, as demonstrated by Dr. James H. Cone, is his magnum opus. And the cross and the lynching tree emerge from and are informed by specific events, codes of behavior, and other socio-historical factors. Lynching narratives remind us that while bodies may not sway from poplar trees or from oak trees on the courthouse lawns, we must think long and hard before we conclude too prematurely that lynching is a past practice. With rare exception, lynching narratives offer us a remarkable glimpse into the human capacity to forgive without forgetting, to survive and even thrive in the midst of unimaginable evil. When we consider the generation of elders who lived with the present threat of danger, perhaps our challenge is to assign value to their narratives as primary sources from which to engage with theologians, scholars, and countless others who present a sanitized cross and divorce themselves from a lynching tree.
White on black violence began during the Middle Passage and persists into the present. Lynchings proper took place right after the Civil War from post-Reconstruction and into the mid-next century and morphed into different forms of white on black terrorism. The Dyer anti-lynching bill was not proposed to Congress until 1917, when the progressive era was coming to an end. Attempts to account for this phenomenon are anything but satisfactory, sometimes very often superficial. In A Festival of Violence, an analysis of Southern lynchings, the authors show that within the lynching era, there was a definite season for mob activity. More lynchings occurred from May through September. Lynchings were especially concentrated during the hot summer months of June, July, and August. On the other hand, mob violence dampened considerably during the winter. Now, I'm mentioning this because we should make it perfectly clear, especially from the research of Dr. Sims, Angela Sims, that these statistical patterns sociologists can produce in hindsight do not in any way mean that blacks living in these areas from which the statistics were drawn felt any less threatened by whites during the months indicated of low incidence. I'm citing the study to document the seasonal nature of lynchings in order to ground my discussion of lynching's ritualistic character. The observation that lynching had political, sociological, and economic functions of intimidating blacks who were competitors with whites of marginal status in a struggling southern economy is obvious and begs the real question, why did these whites have the need to kill blacks in such an horrendous fashion? A lot of ways to kill somebody. Many other forms that white on black violence could have assumed. But why did it assume the form it did is a question more amenable to psychoanalytic than sociological description. The gruesome details of lynching indicate that these acts gratified some deep-seated collective psychosexual needs of American culture and society. According to one scholar, quote, within the context of the Den of Horrors, What is it about white smiling white faces that they gaze upon the mutilated, that gaze upon the mutilated black body? It suggests that these smiling faces are indicable of people having experienced an event that was pleasurable. One should not overlook the homoerotic elements placed out in the spectacle. In removing the black penis and white men's embracing the same penis they were so overdeterminately driven to destroy, one encounters a sadistic enactment of the homoerotic at the very moment of its most extreme disavowal. End quote. Hence, lynching's religious symbolism suggests more than even Cohn said explicitly. Lynching was one expression of a type of American evangelical piety whose deity was whiteness. That's the religion, Professor, that they were engaging in, a religion of whiteness. That it was contrary to the basic morality of Christian faith does not automatically disqualify it as religious phenomenon if it served religious and cathartic functions for the perpetrators. The ritualistic and fetishistic nature of many lynchings has been well documented. In other words, calling attention to the atrocity is not enough. White people feeling sorry about it is not enough. The act itself and the act of seeing the act must be explicated, two different things. The explication, however, places the victim and the victimizer in two different locations. Dr. Cohn does a marvelous job in describing how African Americans viewed lynching, but I am wondering, and indeed, if I've read Sadia Hartman correctly, if there might be some danger in encouraging or allowing our whites, except the brother on the panel, quick access to this sentiment. Looming from the pages of Dr. Cohn's The Cross and the Lynching Tree is the terror and violence that, while so integral to America's history and character, remains masked by the ideologies of American exceptionalism, benevolence, and divinely ordained world mission. Cohn focuses our gaze upon lynchings that constitute, in continuity with slavery and the genocide of Native American peoples, American history's underside. Everyone on this panel has emphasized that. The book's title signals Cohn's critique of American theology's complicity in white-on-black terror by not seeing in the mangled lynch-black body hanging like Billie Holiday and Nina Simone's Strange Fruit, the crucified body of Jesus. The American Christ was the blonde-haired, blue-eyed, resurrected Christ, but not the black, nappy-headed humanity hanging from the lynching tree. Not the one W.B. Du Bois wrote about in his short story, Jesus Christ in Georgia, or the Langston Hughes poem, Jesus Christ in Alabama, not the one Conti Cullen talked about, or any of the other African-American literary figures whom Cohn exposes us to. He further states at the conclusion of his essay, the cross and the lynching tree interpret each other before asking whether the cross can redeem the lynching tree and the lynching tree liberate the cross from sentimental piety. Dr. Cohn added, these are the questions I have tried to answer. And then Dr. Cohn suggests, and what I'm calling a theological aesthetic of the cross and the lynching tree, Cohn says on page 162, through the pain of Jesus' cross, though the pain of Jesus' cross was real, there was also joy and beauty in his cross. God's loving solidarity can transform ugliness, whether Jesus on the cross or the lynched black victim into beauty, into God's liberating presence. Through the powerful imagination of faith, we can discover the terrible beauty of the cross and the tragic beauty of the lynching tree. And that's good prose, but I think Cohn went too far right there. And so, so this is the only criticism I have of the book. Everybody said the book is good, the book is great, but but now, I'm criticizing Cohn's proposal. Let us analyze the aesthetic implicit in Dr. Cohn's proposal. It is, in my view, quite problematic because it tends to undermine the thrust of his argument up to that point on two scores. Firstly, it mismatches literary tropes and philosophical categories. The Niebuhr brothers had a big debate about the implication of life's tragic dimension for U.S. foreign policy and Christian social ethic. And although Cohn rightly takes the Niebuhrs to task for not addressing the race problem and the prevalence of lynching, he may have inadvertently bought into one of the Niebuhr brothers' notion in the title, Beyond Tragedy. We cannot join the angle of aesthetic apprehension of African-Americans and Euro-Americans without explicating the prerequisite transformations in social location this entails. And I'm relying on Brother Matthew Johnson's book, The Tragic Vision of African-American Religion, and Burke and some other Kant's work on the sublime. And the sublime, you see, when you take something that's terrible, that's horrible, and you look at it and derive an aesthetic value from it, you're looking at something terrible. It's different than looking at something beautiful. And so the cross functions as an object through which we experience the aesthetic of the sublime. Now, how is it possible that you can experience the aesthetic of the sublime by looking at something terrible? It's because you can look at it, you can view it from a safe enough distance. That's the only way it works. And black people and white people, and then we could bring in the class analysis, cannot view the cross from the same angle of location because black people can't view it from a distance. They're in it. It's not an object outside, it's a symbol that you produce to interpret your experience, but it's not an extraneous object. And Cohn says that in the book, and he said it last night. I heard. So that's my critique, and I want to kind of finish real quick so we have more time. So you saw Dr. Cohn, because you read that I was invoking Sadia Hartman's book, because she talks about the crises of witnessing. And it's real tricky when you want to identify with someone else's suffering. It's very tricky because you can inadvertently displace the person who's suffering in your identification with the person. That's what Sadia says. Now, the other thing that I don't say in the paper, and this is the challenge for all of us, because when I've been working on this thing, even we as black scholars can be guilty of using the data of the suffering of our ancestors in a way that I'm critiquing white folks because it's at a distance. And so we're just dredging it up and using it in order to get tenure or whatever. And so what qualifies us, even as black scholars, to move into the lynching tree is our sacred, our holy ground. I'm making a hermeneutical move where I'm saying for Moses, it was the burning bush. And for black people, it's the lynching tree. That's our holy ground. But what qualifies us to tread on that holy ground in our scholarship?
Appreciate those papers. We're now going to have Dr. Cohn respond to these papers.
Thank you very much. This is the third panel on my work at this meeting. One last night, one this morning, and now this one. One cannot ask for more. And I want to thank, in regards to this panel, Dr. Raymond Carr for organizing this excellent panel. He asked me at the last AAR meeting if he could organize a panel to respond to my book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree. I had not met him before, and I reluctantly agreed, even though I'm always happy to talk about my work with others. So I'm deeply grateful for all the work that he has done to make this gathering happen. He wrote his doctoral dissertation on Carr, Bart, and James Cone. That's me. And we talked about that. And like Cameron Carter, he thinks there is something in Bart and me that can illuminate the theological enterprise. When Bart's theology and Cone's theology are seen in relation to each other. I told him I left Bart a long time ago. But he said, no, you have not. As I said last night and at this morning's session, on the new black theology, critics can see things in your work that you do not. I'm also grateful to the panelists for the quality of their responses to my book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree. If my book could generate such excellent responses, then the time I have spent researching and thinking and writing it is well worth the effort, which was actually approximately 10 years. Now I want to respond to each panelist and then sit down. As I read Professor Angela Sims' deeply moving response to my book, I could only say thank you for understanding what I was trying to write about. Your insight deepens and extends my reflection. I also want to thank you for the excellent work you are doing on lynching, interviewing our elders who remember lynching. The voices of our elders are the real sources for theological reflection, she says. And you are correct. Historical remembrance is a theological mandate. Oral epistles, as Dr. Sims describes this remembrance, are courageous truth-telling. Sims continues, as she said, my research with persons who remember lynching suggests that their faith in God enabled them to arrive at a point where they refuse to allow the lynching culture to dictate their humanity. Then she mentions the recollection of Catherine Clark Fetcher and how she decided not to allow someone else's hatred to determine her worldview. And when that moment occurred, she said a heavy burden had been lifted, and she had let the hate go. Sims calls this the process of rebirth, and I agree. I want to thank Richard Hughes, the only white on this panel, for taking that risk to be here in the midst of all of this, because we can get mean sometime. And I want to thank him for his books about myths that Americans live by. But I want to thank him for the excellent and deeply removing reflection on my book. It takes a whole lot of courage for white theologians and scholars to speak the truth about race and to do it personally and not just abstractly. If we had more white theologians and religion scholars who would break their silence about white supremacy and face it for what it is, we together could also make a better world, create more committed churches, and more creative theologians. It is still puzzling to me how white theologians can write volumes about Christian theology and not wrestle with white supremacy's contradiction of the gospel. I still cannot understand how white Christians could lynch black people and still not see how that lynching contradicts the Christian gospel. I cannot understand why white theologians let these white Christians off the hook, let them get away with that heresy. We have more theologians like Richard Hughes and Nathan Kerr, who spoke last night, there is hope for theology in the white community. And I will say to you that you cannot make a future for white theology without dialoguing with black and other theologians of color. It is not easy for me to respond to my former student, Dwight Hopkins, because he was my student. I want first to thank him for all the work that he has done in the development of black liberation theology in that second generation. He has, in this report and in his paper tonight, he has, I would say, I have to be honest here, made an adequate reflection on my book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree. I say adequate because it is correct interpretation, but only adequate because he has not himself contributed to that discussion. It is the task of theologians not only to explain, but not only to interpret what another has said, but to make a contribution, take a risk in that discussion. I think Dwight should answer the questions that he put to me. And perhaps by doing that, he will make the contribution his own by extending it and by deepening it, taking it in directions that I did not go. Now, I want to say a word to James Noel for his challenging and critical response to my book, focusing on the phrases, the terrible beauty of the cross and the tragic beauty of the lynching tree, which I borrowed from Reinhold Niebuhr, and Niebuhr borrowed from that Anglo-Irish poet William Butler Yeats, which was used in his great poem, Easter 1916. The phrase tragic beauty was used also by the black poet, County Cullen, in his poem, The Black Christ, saying to a lynch victim, never such tragic beauty shone as this on any face before. I understand Professor Noel's objection to seeing beauty in something so ugly as the lynching tree. I understand that objection in order to guard against an easy access of whites to this experience without paying their dues, to use James Baldwin's language. I will continue to think long and hard about Professor Noel's critique, which reminds me my longtime friend Charles Long's challenging critique throughout my life. He's that thorn in my side. And I think Professor Noel has deepened that thorn rather than taking it out. I'm an old man now. You don't need to keep twisting the knife. In my response to him, I turned to James Baldwin at the end of three sessions of dialogue on race in 1970 with Margaret Mead. James Baldwin concludes the dialogue by saying, I have to talk about my beginnings, and I did begin here, auctioned like a mule, bred as though I was a stallion, treated as not even a beast is treated, died in ditches, not even as a mule is murdered. I have to remember that. I have to redeem that. I cannot let it go for nothing. The only reason I am here is to bear witness, unquote. And speaking to blacks in 1963, Baldwin says to them, I beg black people of this country to do something which I know is very difficult, to be proud of that auction block and all that rope and all that fire, and all that pain, unquote. My concern is to break our silence and to not to let the lynching tree have the last word. I have to redeem that, as Baldwin says. The beauty is in the resistance. It's in the refusal to be even defined by death, the refusal to be defined by the lynching tree. And when we remember the lynching tree, we remember the victim. And through that remembrance, we affirm their beauty and the ugliness of white supremacy. That is the theological paradox. The blues and the spirituals are expressions of that beauty. It is perhaps because I think as a theologian and as a poet, and James Noel as a historian of the religion corrupted by Charles Long, that we see things, different things, in the cross and the lynching tree. But I say to him, I believe that despite what he might think, we will end up in the same place. Thank you.
We only have about 5 minutes, and so we're willing to take one or two questions, about two questions, to our panel. And for anyone that want to ask a question, there are some mics right here up front.
Thanks for this wonderful panel and for another fine series of reflections on Dr. Cone's work. I sort of want to pick up on Professor Cone's response to Dr. Noel, if I got the name right?
Noel.
Thank you. I sort of heard a kind of response inside of Professor Cone's rejoinder. But I'm interested in, I found your invocation of Sadia Hartman's work very, very interesting and actually powerful in its own way. Because I wonder if there's a way in which Hartman's work actually assists and aids Dr. Cone's work. I'm thinking about those parts in Sadia Hartman's work that talks about how there's a kind of space of fugitivity, as it were, inside of the practices of the everyday, such that the practices of domination around the everyday are not totalizing, but they're actually like a zone of retreat, so to speak, that creates the possibility of resistance, shall we say, creates new possibilities out of it. And I wonder if that's a way to actually think about what you're trying to get out of the cross and both the cross and the lynching tree, that these practices of terror, as it were, though they strove to be totalizing in their dominating gestures, nevertheless had these, they couldn't be totalizing. And so actually, I'm not sure if the sublime is maybe adequate to how blacks tried to negotiate slavery, lynching tree, and domination. So I'd be very interested to hear your response on that. I mean, part of this is I'm just wondering if Sadia's work actually destabilizes the way in which the sublime could be mobilized to sort of put pressure back on Dr. Cone, but actually reinforce his point.
Yeah. I'm going to be brief. The issue I'm raising is the difference in location. Remember at the beginning, I said there's the act of lynching, and there's the act of seeing the act. Mm-hmm. Now, we're all here looking at the act of lynching. Now we have to look at ourselves looking
at the act.
And what happens when we look at ourselves looking? Now, I agree entirely with what my brother predecessor, there's no African-American in this room who wouldn't have been here because of if Cone hadn't have done what he's done. I want to just say that, but I didn't have a chance because I would, you know, to say that. But I'm nervous about Langston Hughes said, they done taken my blues and gone. I'm nervous that the invitation may be so gracious that white folks will take my lynching tree and be gone and find it beautiful. See, that's, you got to, see, if a white person is looking at it and says it's beautiful, I don't know what that means. That's all I'm saying. And that's what Sadia Hartman is saying, page 34, The Crises of Witnessing, where she's talking about an abolitionist who completely identifies with a slave on an auction block to the point where she says he displaces the presence of the slave. Mm-hmm. So I haven't worked it out, so there has to be some distance I see. You don't displace, but at the same time, the distance can't be a safe distance where you're just exploiting, footnoting the misery of an experience over here, an experience over here, goes into...
Right. No, I that's
so beautiful. I don't have it completely worked out, but that's the issue, the conversation we're having.
Just one last point. That's powerful. I take that point. That is powerful. But I wonder if part of what Professor Cohn is getting at, to take, you know, I love what I was just telling the person I was sitting next to, how much I appreciate your talk. But I wonder if in some sense what Professor Cohn is trying to mobilize around the cross and the lynching tree is to actually disrupt the logic, the second move, us looking at the act, our act of gazing upon the act of lynching, and in fact trying to reverse, almost imagine the lynching tree as an icon. Rather than us looking at it, it's looking at us. And if we change the operation of the gaze, it destabilizes our effort to capture it and stabilize it.
Well,
right?
This sister's research, there's the person on the tree who's looking at you. So there's white folks that are doing, or people, perpetrators, and then there's you as an African American who is scared to be there because you're afraid they might do it to you. This thing is scary, you know? And not only that, I was at the museum, I was looking at the crucifixions. There are pictures of people taking Jesus down from the cross. And I'm wondering, black folks were afraid to take their loved ones down from the lynching tree. And I'm an artist, I'm a visual artist. Brother Cohn is a poet. That's my next series of paintings. What does that look like?
And this is why we call it critical conversations on the cross and lynching tree. So thank you all for coming.